Hi, this is David Kuhn. I'm here today to show you our ownR platform in action and tell you a little bit more about it. I'm going to start with logging in. And what you can see now is a new landing page where you can see all the applications you have already access to. So let me tell you, what is the ownR platform? First and foremost, it's a production platform for R and Python applications. What do we mean by R and Python in production? We mean API applications or web applications such as Dash and Shiny. I'm going to go ahead and choose the language and the version. For now, I'm going to choose Python 3.7. And I'm going to choose an API application first for this demo. What you can see is already an automatically generated API key. I'm going to go ahead and change that to something else for this purpose of this demo to make life easier. And I'm going to choose an application name, and now I can create the application. I could also scale it up and down from one replicas to multiple, and I can also restrict deployment targets, but that's not for this video. I'm going to create the application. What happened in the background is a long list of wonderful things. There is a new container created dedicated to this application, so it's separated from all other applications running in production. The correct version of Python has been pre-installed with a nice virtual environment, and a Git repository has been created to support our CI/CD workflow. Here you can also add a description for the application. This is a Python API demo. You can still change at any later point. You can change the programming language or the programming language version. You can change the app type, or you can scale the app up and down. You can change the API key, etc. You can also add environmental variables and predefined and pre-configured mounts to the container where this application is running. If you, for example, need a storage space for storing your web scraping results or your pre-trained model, this is the way to do that. Once the application is ready, I'm gonna just start it. And to show you that it's running nicely, I'm gonna just call this API. I'm gonna use our internal IDE based on Visual Studio Code. I already have pre-set up for myself a nice little script, Python script, that I can post to this URL. I can say which function I want to call in our demo application. It's an echo function that does what it says. It just echoes back whatever comes in the argument n. I have used API key demo, and now I'm just gonna make a post request and see what the result looks like. What you can see is, as promised, 20 went in, 20 came out. This is how an API works. You just simply post your inputs, the Python code will run, and the result will be sent back. In this format, return value will be the result, and any warnings and errors will be also provided here. Now, APIs in the ownR platform can also be called asynchronously. To call an API asynchronously, all you need to do is add the async true predicament to the function call. I'm gonna change this to the correct API key, and I'm gonna run the same code as before, but now asynchronously. So as you can see the difference here, instead of a return value, I got a task ID. And now if I use this task ID and I send it to a slightly different URL, which is slash result for the same URL, and I send as data, not a function call, but the task ID, I will get the result back. Why this is nice? Well, if you imagine that this is a long-running application, but you expect multiple calls to it, then sending it asynchronously, they will just run in parallel on whatever infrastructure you are using, and you can just query it and ask, is it ready, is it ready? And once it's ready, you will get the return value. This is how our APIs work. Now, because of the asynchronous behavior, sometimes you want to see what's happening in the API. For that reason, you also have a dashboard. where you can view your API. You can see the workers under it. You can see how many API calls have you made. Well, I have just made this application and I made two calls. So you can see the two processed and the two succeeded. And you can dig a little in, see what was happening, what was the inputs, outputs, etc. So this is how our API in Python works. Now let's see what happens if I do the same with an R API that I have prepared already upfront. Exactly the same view. This is in R3.5, but it could also be R3.6 or R3.4, R3.3 or R3.2. I have a different API key. I'm gonna also change this for, I'm gonna change this to test for just to show you. I'm gonna save and I'm gonna reload this application. When I reload the application, it gets redeployed. Now I'm gonna take this API URL. I will come back here to my trusted VS Code. I'm gonna change the URL to the, if the R API demo, I'm gonna change the API key to the correct one. And I'm gonna just send the same results and see the same, just to show you that it actually really is running. If I change the 10 to 200, I get 200 back. Why this is important is because that means that the consumer of the API does not have to know if this is R or if it's Python. All they have to know is how the API is working, what functions are supported, what inputs are expected, and the URL for the API. Consumer doesn't have to know if you are working in R or if you are working in Python. Exactly the same goes to the web type of application. So this is an R web application. In other words, it's a Shiny app. And for Shiny apps, you get a very nice URL that is fixed, just like for the API applications. And this is just a standard Shiny app that works as advertised. But for web applications, we don't have API keys. Instead, we have user management. So in the user management, you can decide to add or remove users. I'm gonna remove test, or I can add it back. Only the users who are listed here, plus the administrators of the platform, can see, can access this application. So go ahead and try access this URL. All right, let's just go ahead. With the admin user, then there you go. We have now access to the application. The same goes for Dash. So if it's a web application, but Python, then it's a Dash application. And again, everything for your end user is exactly the same. They do not have to know whether it's Shiny, it's Dash. They don't have to know what the owner platform is. They get a URL they can log into, and they can interact with your dashboard. Now, I was mentioning that we have a CI/CD workflow for which we have Git. So let's see what happens. If I copy this Git URL, I do not want a notebook right now, thank you, I want a VS Code. I go to Visual Studio Code. I'm gonna clone this application I have just been showing you. It will ask or password. Now I have a demo dash application, and in the demo dash application, I have a demo dash.py. And in this file, I'm gonna change the header from live model training view to hello dash. I'm gonna save this. So now in Git, I can see that I have made changes. I'm gonna say commit all. My commit message is hello dash. I'm gonna push to master. And what happens when I push to master, let's visit this page again, is that this application is now offline for a second until the redeployment happens. And while we wait for the redeployment of my beautiful dash demo, let me tell you a little bit more about other parts of the platform. As I said, first and foremost, the platform is a production environment for R and Python applications. But for developers, we have also Visual Studio Code. You have already seen that. You don't notice that the Visual Studio Code is also running in a container dedicated to each and every developer separately, so you can install your stuff and nobody else will be affected. Now, thank you, Dash. What you can see now is I changed something in my application. I did a git push and my application is updated. Isn't that wonderful? No need for IT. Everything is under the developer's control. So as I was saying, the Visual Studio Code environment is dedicated to every developer user. So is the notebook environment every developer user gets. A notebook environment. Let's create a new one. So I'm just gonna say launcher, and I can just say choose a Python or an R version, and I can just say import sys.version. Ah, it doesn't help if I make a typo. And you see that this is a Python 3.7 notebook kernel. Again, you can install notebook extensions, you can install packages, and because this is dedicated to you, the other users will not be affected. If anything goes wrong, just restart this container and you reset to the factory default. Now, next to end users who only get access to applications where they are authorized, and developers, you also have admin users. Admin users have even more rights. They get to enable and disable users. They can impersonate users and act just for testing purposes, act in their name. They get also a tool to monitor what's happening in the platform, memory, CPU, file system, and network. And they also get access to the underlying Docker. That was it, folks. This is how the ownR platform supports your everyday business. As you have seen, actually you have not seen, let me show you that one last thing. When I created my API, I haven't told you this, but actually it's based on a simple Python module. There is no API written by me by hand. Let me just git clone this and show you exactly what I'm talking about. This is my Python API demo, and the Python API demo, there is only a demo file, and all it does is the function definition. So you do not need to create the API yourself. That's automatically taken care of you for you by the platform. This is the beauty of this platform. We automate a lot of the data engineering and IT tasks such as security, user management, containerization, and creation of APIs. All you need to do is build your model, build your data products in Shiny or Dash, or create a Python module where you expose your functions, deploy everything, and it will be running. Thank you very much. That was it for today.